Now we will have a panel on the role of SMEs and vocational training. What are the most promising policies to create employment opportunities? What is the role to be played by the SMEs? And how far is training and financing important to reinforce the market, the employment market? A panel, but we will watch a small footage on the next two panels, and then we will start our panel. The next panel is going to be addressed by Mr. Mounir Fakhry Abdel, the Minister of Trade and Industry in Egypt. And it will also be addressed by Mr. Mario Spangenberg, President and Managing Director, General Motors Africa. He's from South Africa. Mr. Habib Haddad, the CEO of Wamda, the United Arab Emirates. Mrs. Heba, the founder of the Egypt Network for Integrated Development, Egypt. And the moderator will be Sir Burton Sorrell. He is the CEO of WPP from the United Kingdom. Well, now we are going to see this footage on the next two panels.
Progress values its people. Human capital is the greatest resource of any country. It is the fuel, the energy that drives innovation. Innovation that will lead Egypt into the 21st century. Building a society that values its talent is paramount. Educating and engaging the youth. Empowering individuals from all walks of life. Creating meaningful employment for men and women. Embracing people and creating social inclusions is the key to progress. The key to a new and stronger Egypt.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Early morning start on the Sunday morning, but a large number of people here. I think you've introduced the speakers, so I won't belabor the introduction. We have a limited amount of time. But so what I'd like to do is to kick off with the minister. I think you were introduced. My Egyptian is not that good enough to know what they said about you, but I got a drift of it. But a little known fact is that apart from being a banker in the opposition and now in government, you were a jam maker. Correct?
Correct.
Now, as a jam maker, you're well aware of the challenges of SMEs, vocational training, education, investment, and SMEs, all joking aside, are the engine room of job creation. And I think for the first few minutes, it would be very interesting for us to understand, certainly people from outside Egypt, what the government's policy is in relation to SME development, vocational training, and maybe we can broaden it a bit to education.
Yes. Let me start by saying that it is not only an engine for job creation. It's an engine for growth. You cannot have growth without opening the door for new entrants in the economy, without giving support to small enterprise in order to grow and to become a medium one and to support the medium-sized enterprise to become a large enterprise. So it is also an engine for growth, but also it is an engine for social inclusion. We need to include youth, we need to include women, we need to include disabled, and this happens through SME support. But also it is a way to ensure balanced development, to take care of the geographical areas that have been neglected during the past decades as far as Egypt is concerned. So yes, it is for Egypt, for Egypt's government, a definite priority to support SMEs. And to do so, we have, first of all, unified the definition of the small, the micro, the small and the medium-sized enterprise. And unfortunately, we had several definitions that were given to banks, given to NGOs, given to the government, given in the law, and it is impossible to be able to map and to strategize and develop SMEs without a single definition. So this is where we started. But also, we had introduced a reform, an institutional reform, between three institutions, namely the Social Fund for Development, the Industrial Modernization Center and Industrial Training Center, and coordinated their action and their roles in order to take care of the SMEs during the different stage of their development, starting by the pre-start stage, whereby, and this is extremely important, whereby we want to spread the culture of the small enterprise, where we want to create young entrepreneurs that would think of having an enterprise, a small project, instead of looking for a governmental job. And this is unfortunately the hope of every young Egyptian, and we have to change that culture. So we're starting by the pre-startup stage, and then we take up the idea and let it grow, give it the necessary technical support, marketing support, and training for the workers in that small project in order to increase the productivity of the workers. Now, there are several ideas that are currently being implemented. A project called AYADI that is in which the government, as a matter of fact, the Minister of Planning has been the major promoter. That is, the Ministry of Industry has, and the Social Fund has a project called Intalik in order to promote young entrepreneurship. NGOs, and here Heba Handoussa is there, she has an NGO that is promoting SMEs. We're trying to support the linkages between the small enterprise and the large enterprise. Linkages are a guarantee for sustainability, continuity.
So that would be, for example, through the supply chain.
Absolutely.
In the case of GM.
Absolutely.
And the autos.
Absolutely. And the idea is to create clusters for SMEs in the industrial zones to establish the relations between the SME and the large enterprise to create a linkage that would guarantee, as I said, the sustainability and the continuity and the success of the small enterprise. In addition, I have to say that the World Bank has given $300 million loans to the Social Fund for Development, and the Board of Social Fund for Development has decided to earmark 5% of this amount to finance venture capital, to take equity participation in small projects, and this would definitely help promoting the SMEs. Finally, I have to say that SMEs in Upper Egypt are of utmost importance. Upper Egypt has been extremely neglected during the last decades, and a way to create jobs, to develop this unfortunately neglected region would be through the creation of SMEs. Last thing, we're also supporting the artifacts and handmade products, especially those that are concentrated in small villages. And this is very, very, it happens very often in Egypt, whether in the Delta or in Upper Egypt, because it has a fantastic regional impact on regional development.
Okay, so picking up from that, Heba, one of the few women panelists at this conference, and a lady that was trained at a number of famous universities in London, I'm delighted to say. Heba, you have a number of projects that you're involved in the southern part of the country, the more neglected part of the country. Do you want to just briefly, because I know you're passionate about this stuff, but briefly just run through two or three of the things that you're doing at the moment?
I'm passionate about Egypt's revolution, and that's what drew me to move to the south in terms of development work. We have 72 founding members, and for a full year in 2012, we just spent it studying the opportunities in the south, and we found many, many of them. So I've brought with me three projects that I believe can be scaled up, meaning replicated. We've done a beautiful ready-made garments factory for export, and we had the technical assistance from Egypt's Export Council for ready-made garments, and they will be bringing the patterns, designs, fabric, and paying on a subcontracting basis per piece. And I think this, we could have thousands of these. And please remember that in the south, it's mostly rural, okay? People think of Luxor and a lot of hotels, but more than 80% of the people are living in the countryside, and you have 94% of Egypt's 1,000 poorest villages in the south or upper Egypt. So it's very inexpensive labor as well. I'm talking to business people. We've been looking for profitable opportunities. We have the entire feasibility study, and we're actually implementing them so that you can come and see them and replicate them, hopefully. We also have the first integrated fish farm using solar energy for pumping water in the fringe of the desert, which is the Zahir Sahrawi. And we hope that fish will become cheaper than poultry. It's very ambitious. It's not very costly. And it's fully integrated with cultivation and livestock, I mean sheep, and the and biogas production. The third project that I'm bringing with me, and for those of you interested, you can ask for them on the way out, we have an eco-lodge, which again is very low cost, for 20 rooms in the middle of the countryside, which is exquisite, as those of you who've been on a Nile cruise have seen. And the rate is $35 per night, not the most expensive, but you really get
What an advertisement. You should be in our business. Go ahead.
We're mostly working with women, okay, because unfortunately until today, the rate or level of participation of women in the labor force, whereas it's 23% on average for Egypt, it's only 10% in Upper Egypt. Women have very little opportunities, but their aspirations, we've created aspirations, and they're very keen to learn, and they acquire skills very fast, very, very fast, and they're producing already under the OVOP model, the One Village, One Product, 22 different crafts, which were totally male-dominated in the north. We've brought them down to Qenna and Luxor and Soheg, and we're hoping to create an export consortium, and the minister has been very helpful in setting up for us the first export council for handicrafts.
Okay, so well, now that you've raised a number of questions there, or I think you have questions of scale. We'll come to Mario on scale in a minute. But we have the minister trapped on stage now. We have another 30-plus minutes. What would you like to see the minister doing, if anything, that he and his department and his portfolio are not doing? What would you like to see him
do? I've been to India and learned a lot of lessons and took 12 of our best craftspeople from Egypt to learn some of the production methods that have been really supported by government in India. And I'd very much like to get the same kind of vocational training in the formal schooling system. In just one governorate where offices are. Qena, we have 23 industrial technical schools, and they could do with a lot of refurbishing. But we've worked with five, and it takes less than a year because the teachers are very good. All they need is to have an upgrading, access to raw materials, and most important, and that's a request from the Minister of Finance, I don't know if he's with us, is to abolish the taxes paid on the income made by sales by schools. If the schools are allowed to sell their products, and that's why we've set up the first ready-made garments inside the technical school, they will need the government.
So this is the development of nodes around schools. You've seen it in America around universities. You've seen it in Europe amongst many universities as well. You see this in Bangalore, for example, in India and in São Paulo in Brazil. So you're talking about the development of academic institutions, training schools that then develop industries. And we'll come to VC, venture capital, with Habib as well in a minute. So you have your brief, Minister. Heba has set you your task. Let me just turn to this question of scale, because as we were saying in the green room, Heba, when people talk about arts and crafts or eco-lodges, they think small scale. So Mario, who is, when you read his CV, you don't know whether he's German, whether he's Egyptian, what he is, but he actually is an American. He's actually from New York and is a VW, Volkswagen, Skoda as well, I think I saw in the CV, and GM, General Motors, Lifer. So this is big industry, and you're the market leader here in Egypt in the automotive industry, and you're generating, you have what, 2,000 jobs here?
That's correct.
Direct jobs, but in the supply chain, there's how many jobs?
About 25,000.
Right, so you're a key generator of employment and a priority for the minister and his department and the government. So do you want to talk a little bit about the scale and the impact on the supply chain? We're talking about SMEs here, but obviously it has implications, what you do for SMEs, and on training, vocational training, I guess, first, and then more generally the educational system, which Heba has touched on in Egypt.
Sure. First, I'm going to take a cue from Heba, though. This seems to become a selling show, so I want to introduce the Chevrolet and Opel product to everybody and have you all come to our showrooms at Al Mansour and buy them. Having said that, the auto industry encompasses essentially everything what this conference is about. It encompasses jobs, from the most basic jobs to the highly skilled technical jobs in manufacturing to business-oriented jobs. In addition, we not only have direct jobs in the factories, we also have the jobs that we generate through the supply industry. So you have all facets of employment, and with that comes training. We trained last year, just at General Motors alone, an average of 25,500 hours. That translates into every employee having 5 days of training, as far as white-collar employees are concerned, and technical employees had an average of 3 days of training. Furthermore, you go into, let's say, our supply chain. They do training for their employees. In fact, the supply industry was set up by General Motors. We were the first OEM in this country. We came in 1983. We're the ones that brought with us the supply industry. We taught them, we set them up, and many of them are not only suppliers to us now, but also to some of our co-competitors, and some of them actually export some of their material out of the country as well. And then you go beyond that to the dealership level. We also provide training for our technical personnel to repair the occasional vehicle. And we have schools in Upper Egypt as well, together with our friends from Al Mansour. And we guarantee, after a training program, that each one of those technical people, which we've trained 170 mechanics in Upper Egypt since 2007, each of them get a job for at least 1 year. And together with government support and a university from Canada, these are the kind of programs that really help in the country. So the auto industry does essentially what you want in this country, every set of jobs, and by the way, we also have 21% women in the auto industry, and with our chairwoman, Mary Barra, the focus on women in the auto industry is getting even bigger every day. So we're really happy to be part of this.
You know how to play to the crowd. let me just come and ask you a very direct question, because and maybe a tough question, but I will ask it. In China, it is commonly accepted you have a joint venture structure. In fact, the Chinese auto market is now the biggest auto market in the world, 22 million units. The American market being 17 million units. Worldwide market, I think, is about 60 million units in terms of demand. The JV structure is accepted there, and in fact, the JV player in many cases is the dominant partner, and increasing production, for example, Ford Motor Company in China, when they increased their production there, they had to negotiate with their JV partner and surrender IP control. The structure you have here, interestingly, GM owns, 31%, I think you said?
Correct.
Of the company here. Suzu owns another 20, and then local partner, the 50. Direct question. Is that a structure that you're happy with?
Absolutely.
But seriously, I mean, when you think about the effort that you're making, and there is this balance, is 31% enough, or should it be more?
Look, when we came here originally in 1983, I think the region was considered a very volatile region. It continues to be challenging and lots of fun, actually. I spent 2 years during the revolution here, and it's exhilarating to come and see how much activity you can find. So therefore, what we were looking for when we set it up, it was an investment to bring the expertise in here, to bring our product in here, and to find commitment from not only the local government, the local partners, and trying to now take more, than that 31% is actually impossible, because our local partners and shareholders are very happy with the business, and we're happy. So would we buy a little more? We might, but we're perfectly happy with what we're doing, and we should add to the fact that the distribution happens through our partner Al Mansour.
Right.
And generally, we are not in the distribution business, but in this particular case, we're also 10% partner of
the dealer network.
In the retail operation. So as a total, the package works very well.
Okay, interesting. Minister, you wanted to...
I think Mario failed to say two things. One, that despite the volatility described, 2014 was a record year in production and sales for GM and for the automotive industry in Egypt. And number two, that his production facility in Egypt is one of the most productive in the world as a result of the training he's been given to Egyptian workers. And I want to say that Egyptian labor in general, when given the adequate training and the proper incentives, becomes extremely productive. This is the case of GM. This is the case of Samsung. They told us so yesterday in that session. And I think training is key for the development of Egypt and for the development of industry in Egypt.
So energy industry is key in job creation and, in fact, in infrastructure development. Automotive industry is key. Minister, would you like to see the number two in the market is Hyundai, I think you said, Matt?
That is correct.
Yeah. Would you like to see more motor manufacturers establishing plants in Egypt or not?
No, it's not a question of numbers. I want to see the local content in production increasing. Unfortunately, the structure of the automotive industry in Egypt is very unhealthy. We have 17 auto assemblers, and as a result, none of them really enjoys the benefits of economies of scale, and none of them is taking advantage of the free trade agreements that we have with the Arab world, the African countries, East African countries, the EU, and so on and so forth. So I believe this industry, this sector, needs consolidation, and I prefer to see two or three big, large producers enjoying the benefits of economies of scale, able to compete and to face the competition that we'll be facing starting 2019 from the importation of European cars, import duty-free and quota-free.
And if Egypt is one of the lowest cost producers, presumably the export opportunities are significant as well, no?
Sure.
He's perfectly correct. One of the issues is economies of scale. And with 90 million people, this is a good base, but we obviously have to try and get much more volume in order to make the supply chain work as well, because it's not only about us, it's also about attracting enough suppliers to come here and invest so that you can create more localization.
Sorry, I'll interrupt, and I want to say that together with the Minister of Finance, we're looking at giving special incentives in order to attract large producers in the automotive industry, whether for the production of automobiles or for the production of components. And this is the only way we will be able to build what is a superb tool to industrialize the country. It's a fantastic sector. It, as you said, it raises the skills of the worker. It is labor intensive, but also it is a way to import new technologies.
And we're very much looking forward to that.
What is the unit size of the market here in Egypt?
We produced our record year, as you said, last year, 62,000 units, and that was almost close to 100% capacity.
Yeah.
We're looking to expand that and go up to about 100,000 in the very near future.
And market size in Egypt is what?
I'm sorry, the market
size?
Unit. Last year was a record year of just over 300,000, 301,000. Historic record, I think, for the industry here.
It is expected to double within the coming 5 years.
Okay. Now, our last but not least panelist is a young global leader from the World Economic Forum, Habib, who is the venture capitalist on the panel. So do you want to talk a little bit about the VC industry? The policy of the government is inclusive, and therefore, given the scale of Egyptian human resources, 90 million plus people, two-thirds of which are under 30, the youth and women, and youth unemployment must be around, 25%? Obviously, that's a critical issue. Do you want to talk a little bit about the VC industry and the role that it plays, Habib? You're from originally from Beirut,
from Lebanon.
Yeah. Lebanon. But talk a little bit about how you feel the VC industry can stimulate employment and training and education as well.
Yeah, definitely. I think no one can doubt that there's no country on earth that has proven the power of youth and technology as Egypt has done in 2011. And after that, what we saw, I am from Lebanon, but we operate in all of the Arab world, specifically focused on Egypt, Lebanon, Jordan, and the UAE. And after 2011, you've seen a really amazing talent and youth taking things in their own hands and building startups. After they've been able to do social change, they're trying to do economical change. And we've seen initially a really good early signs of success. Lots of hubs have formed. Cairo and Alexandria have formed a number of accelerators and funds, and VCs have started pouring into this space. But with a few challenges along the way. One of the things that have is something that can be fixed that has happened from 2011 to today is the scale. There has been a lot of work, and the World Bank has put a lot of money, and government has put a lot of policies, but mostly on the ideation phase. In fact, one-fifth of the institutions that have been formed are focused on opening your company. And entrepreneurs, and specifically tech entrepreneurs, don't care about that. They just go illegal until they are going to grow. That's how tech entrepreneurs operate, because it's much cheaper to go and do your thing rather than to plan and figure out your logistics around it. So some data about, if you look at the Arab world today in terms of investment space in the tech startups, the median of investments in Egypt today is about $50,000. Compare that to Jordan, which is $150,000, compare that to Dubai, which is $500,000. That's only to indicate the amount of opportunity and the amount of blockage of scale that startups are facing. So about 66%, or two-thirds of companies, actually in Egypt it's more, about 80% of companies have not received follow-on funding, only received the first check, but then they were left on their own. Compare that to Jordan, for example, which have had a significant success in startups. 55% of companies have received follow-on funding. So all of those are indicators that, you know, there is something to scale. Now, Egypt has a huge local market, obviously, and startups in Egypt have the hugest advantage of tapping into this market. Talking about the distribution of founders, about 18% of the tech startup founders in Egypt are females. But in fact, you know, they're probably the most impactful. In our portfolio, we have an amazing woman who started a company called Supermama, have been scaling quite successfully. There's a couple of companies in the room. I've seen the head of Endeavor, the Eventus, even Dina from Uzov. So there's amazing talent that's being untapped today. Really, really amazing talent that's untapped. I think there's a few things that we need to focus on. The first one is, if we want to focus on women, the first one is the ecosystem is more than welcoming to women, the entrepreneurship ecosystem, but it's the culture, the education that needs to be fixed first. So it's, you know, working a bit earlier in that stage to really encourage women to go into the entrepreneurship space. Number two is, you know, follow-on funding is, I really keep on insisting on that because as we see today in the, you know, in some countries, Lebanon, for example, recently have unlocked, the central bank has unlocked about $400 million of incentives for the local banks to invest in startups. That has really unlocked a huge amount of potential. In Dubai and in Jordan, you have also a lot of new funds. And the third thing I want to talk about, which is really, really important, is, and perhaps the minister can flex his muscle on that, is all those mega projects are being implemented, all those big companies, the GMs of that are working in Egypt, you know, GM is apparently doing a good job on that. They need to be, they put in their own DNA, and they need to be put in their own structure and legally that they need to have 10, 25%, whatever number of their procurement budget going to startups and SMEs. That's a huge untapped secret weapon, and I think, you know, it shouldn't be looked at a small project, it should be looked at as a legacy project, and not just come and build this thing, but come and help me build the future with me.
So, Minister, would you legislate?
It is done.
Okay.
It is done. There's a law giving priority to Egyptian companies, Egyptian products, as a matter of fact, within the public procurement. And within that law, there are some incentives and some preferential treatment for SMEs.
So, Mario, does that apply to the GM procurement department here in Egypt?
Definitely.
Does that apply to the GM procurement department here in Egypt?
Absolutely.
Yes.
So you direct a proportion of your budget to Egyptian supply chain?
Well, in fact, the way it is today for passenger cars, 45% actually of our vehicles are local content. In the commercial vehicles, it goes up to currently 60, moving to 70%. So yes, we work very closely with the local suppliers. And in fact, part of the program that we're hoping that you will be announcing soon will encourage even more incentives as we localize more.
Right.
And that way, it's a win-win for both parties.
Okay. Now, I've not had any questions on my Huawei tablet, as we're in the habit of advertising Huawei's tablet here, from the audience. Anybody has any questions, please? Ah, we have a question here, a hand here. Can we get a microphone or whatever to this gentleman here? Quickly. There we go. Over your right shoulder. There we go.
Dr. Salamoni, Professor of Economics in London, and here we have an investment bank. I just thought General Motor, you produce excellent car and good market, but really the service after sale is absolutely awful, and I hope we can halt that. That's my question. Thank you.
Do you want to comment on that?
That's not nice.
I will tell you this. Our local partners must be watching this on TV, and I will make sure that he improves.
See, you can't win. I mean, you ask for an all-embracing question, and you get consumer complaints.
Well, I tell you, it's amazing. I actually receive them on behalf of the entire continent. We address every individual problem personally. I can tell you one thing, though. If I just go by our statistics of last year, when I came here in 2011, in the middle of the revolution, one of the biggest issues that I found in Egypt in particular was after sales, and we've improved significantly on that. Is there a way to go? There's always a way to go, and there are individual cases. But I'll take your message to heart. It is our not only desire but also obligation to offer not only an outstanding product but an outstanding life cycle experience. And okay. We will continue working on that. Thank you for your comment.
Number four, please. Lady.
Yes, hello. I'm Rawia Mansour, and I'm sorry if you had any problems. I think we should, I think they are, as we speak now, they have a new branch for complaints, if you have any complaints for your cars. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so a positive response. Bravo. Six.
Hamad Temir, a student at the Faculty of Economics and Political Science, Cairo University. So my question is for President Mounir. I read the new industrial law, it's pretty good, but I didn't get the part of how would this law improve these small-sized and medium-sized enterprises regarding the startups.
It's very difficult to hear, actually, because of the echo.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm gonna raise my voice. Regarding the startups, how would the new industrial law improve the startups for the medium and small-sized enterprises? For the new investments and the new small investors.
So the question is, how can we improve the...
Yes, the startups for the medium and small-sized enterprises.
So really, how can the minister and our thoughts on how we could stimulate the growth of small... So what other things, Minister, and this is the burdens of government.
Yes.
What other things, Minister, can you do you feel, to stimulate startup growth?
Well, first of all, I think the question concerned the investment law.
Yeah.
The investment law doesn't have anything to do with SMEs. SMEs are promoted, stimulated through that strategy that I tried to summarize very, very quickly. And it is stimulated by, again, the coordination of the three entities, SFD and IMT, IMC and ITC, plus, in addition to that, the access to finance that is provided through, first of all, the microfinance law that has been promulgated and the microfinance companies that have been established, in addition to the SMEs clusters in the industrial zones. I think the whole structure is building an ecosystem that is extremely favorable to SMEs and should be sufficient.
Heba mentioned India. Heba, do you want to say any other parallels beyond India that you see that could be helpful?
There are two areas where I think the government can help, because it's not a question of access to finance. I think one shouldn't get into borrowing until one has a much lower risk of production and sales. The two big challenges are marketing the product, and one needs a lot of technical assistance, which countries like India provide on how to market. And the other issue is providing this, what Habib was talking about, this interval within which someone's holding your hand as a startup. And I think maybe Habib can tell us more about a specific recommendation.
Okay, go ahead, Habib.
I would actually recommend the government to not do anything, I mean, to get out of the way in the startup space. I would recommend...
I agree.
I mean, coming from Lebanon, I would say I understand that very well. But, you know, I would definitely...
So where would be the model the minister should follow?
So I think government should work a lot to get out of the way. It's not work a little to not get out. I mean, they have to do a lot of work to get out of the way. And I think it's about enabling investors. It's not about investing. So government should never invest directly because they don't understand the investment in space, although Mr. Minister was a banker. And then they should incentivize foreign investment, incentivize foreign companies to come, like GM, to come and open and work with others. So use whatever you can flex your muscles.
But when you say incentivize, what specifically, let's be precise, what would you like to see?
So the government of the UAE have announced 25% minimum of your budget, of your procurement budget, to be spent on SMEs, and that's something apparently that's being implemented. The government of Lebanon has, the central bank in Lebanon has actually unlocked $400 million from the banks to invest in the knowledge economy and small and tiny investments.
Would you see any tax incentives? For example, in Uruguay, there are no tax zones. Around Montevideo, you get a concentration of software development. We've been heavily involved in it throughout Latin America because it's zero tax corporation. Would you see that?
So let me tell you from the way I stand, from the startups and tech startups, taxes is not an issue. Because, I mean, to get to profitability, then worry about taxes, you know, fine. That's actually
accelerated,
a
you could get accelerated investment allowances having the same.
That's like, yeah, so I don't think taxes is too much worry. If you want to spend your eggs in something, don't spend it on tax reforms for startups, because help them get to the place where then they would ask about tax incentives. That's a long way to go for most startups.
Okay. Three.
Ahmed Hussein, financial advisor. I'd like to thank His Excellency the Minister for starting working on a strategy for the development of the SMEs sector. His Excellency pointed four pillars for this.
I would forget about the microphone. It's the echo. None of the panelists, including myself, I think, can understand what the question. Just drop the microphone and just shout.
Years from now for the sector, what's the percentage in contribution to the GDP? What's the percentage contribution to the exports? What percentage to contribute for the national investment? What's the percentage to contribute for the employment? This need to be defined for a strategy.
For SMEs?
Yeah, yes. Second, a very important pillar that need to be included in such a strategy is creating a coordination mechanism. We have many stakeholders for the development of the sector. The government, the private sector, the banking sector, financial institutions, NGOs, all those stakeholders are working on the development of the sector. But there is no coordination mechanism to coordinate between goals, programs, monitoring the performance.
All right. Thank you. Goals and coordination.
Well, if you're talking about percentages, in Egypt, like in most countries around the world, SMEs shares in the GDP is no less than 90%. The problem is the definition of the SME. In the US, an enterprise that employs 500 persons is an SME, is a medium-sized enterprise. In Egypt, it is a large enterprise. So it's a question of definition, but the SMEs in general, the SMEs share in the GDP of all countries represent more than at least 85 to 90%. It is also a job creator, and in most countries, existing jobs are provided by SMEs at the level of 75% at the minimum. So to have a target depends on each and every country. It's a fact. In Egypt, excluding the informal sector, SMEs shares in the GDP is above 90%. Now, speaking of coordination, but this is the whole strategy. I mean, the strategy is all about coordination. I spoke about the coordination between the three governmental institutions, the SFD, the IMC, and the ITC, but those cannot work unless they coordinate with banks, unless they coordinate with NGOs, unless they coordinate with microfinance companies. I mean, the coordination is a prerequisite in order to be able to apply the strategy and to have it successful.
Okay, now, time has run out. There are three questions. Anybody wants to send, my email address is msorrell@wpp.com. Send me the questions and I'll send them on to the panel. A big thank you to the panel, but before we close, I'd like to ask each of the three panelists if they had one wish from the minister. Maybe this minister and the other ministers as well, because it's not just not your portfolio that is affected by these three. What would you like the government to do? One thing. Mario.
I think, speaking on behalf of the auto industry, be very cognizant of the fact that if you turn it into a pure importer industry, you would, A, have trade imbalances, and B, lose a lot of great job transfers and jobs itself and job skills. So I'm very much looking forward to this package that I know you guys are working on, so that we can have a very productive, healthy auto industry, providing jobs to all the diversification that is necessary. Thank you very much.
So a little bit of open lobbying there. Heba.
My wish is that the Ministry of Industry, together with other ministries, like the, especially the Ministry of Finance, would review the imports and prices, because I think that we're not competitive on a lot of micro and small enterprise work because of the cost of raw materials coming from abroad or even local, which has a lot of monopolistic aspects. I think that this has to be reviewed.
Okay, Habib?
Mine is easy, and I'm happy to help on that. I would strongly suggest engaging the startup community that's vibrant and existing into the value, into the decision of what's going to come next, into helping you figure out what's going to happen with all this ingredient that you've assembled and need to cook a really great meal with. So include them in your decision-making process. They're out there, they're very vibrant, and they're very active.
So you want to create a Silicon Valley in the Nile Valley?
Why not?
Okay. And Minister, you have your brief.
No, my brief, first of all, I agree with everything that was said. I agree with what Mario said. It's our aim. You know it. I'm 100% convinced of it. Heba will try and give support to SMEs by providing them with the right price for the raw materials. I perfectly agree. We need to follow up on venture capital to attract SMEs in the in this very skilled technology, knowledge-based products. But I have a wish.
Yep.
I also have a wish.
Good. You're allowed a wish, too.
Thank you. I think we have to revise our education system. You know that the Egyptian government... You know that the Egyptian government has a new portfolio, a new ministry for technical education. That's good. That's perfect. It's one of our priorities. But I strongly believe we need to revise the whole education system in order to have youth able to dream, to innovate, to be creative, to be imaginative. And this is the only way we'll be able to grow.
And that's fun. That's okay. We'll let the women have the last word, as usual. As usual.
I just want to follow up on education. If you follow the survey done by the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor, every year that they've been doing this, and there's something like three or four surveys to date, it's the teaching of entrepreneurship at all levels of education
that's
needed.
Okay, and just finally, that's a very good way to finish, Heba, because this conference has unleashed significant expectations, as we were discussing before. In order to cope with that, fundamental reform of education and entrepreneurship is fundamental and necessary. So thank you to the panel. Thank you, Minister, for being prepared to listen and respond. Thank you.